السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، وأسعد الله جميع أوقاتكم بكل خير. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Our lecture is about immunization. By the end of this lecture, every student should know the types of immunity. He should know the indications of passive immunity, and he will know the importance of vaccination. He will know the basic vaccination program in Palestine. He will know how to give vaccination in special conditions, and he will know some remarks for the different vaccines. He will know the vaccination after exposure to the disease and the contraindication of immunization. Now we will speak about the types of immunity. We have two types of immunity, the passive and active immunity. And each one of them is divided into natural and artificial. Now we have to know an example for each type of the immunity. The example for natural passive immunity, like the immunity reaches the baby during pregnancy and through the placenta. Again, the natural passive immunity is reaching the baby during breastfeeding. An example for artificial passive immunity, which is the ready antibodies, the immunoglobulins given to the patient in certain diseases. While the natural active immunity, the immunity provided to the patient after exposure to the disease or subclinical infection, while the artificial active immunity is the vaccination. Now we have difference between the passive immunity and the active immunity. As we mentioned, passive immunity, the ready antibodies given to the human being, while the active immunity is this an antigen. The duration of the immunity in the passive immunity is it is short. Either this coming through the placenta will take 6 to 12 months and will fade away, while the active immunity usually will take long time, and sometimes it will be lifelong. In some diseases or some vaccination, we need to give several booster doses, while in other vaccination, one vaccination is sufficient. The passive immunity has no memory, just ready antibodies given to protect the patient from the specific disease. While the active immunity, usually there is antibodies, and there is these antibodies, usually after the first vaccine, we'll have primary antibody response, and there will be a memory when we will give the booster dose. Because of the presence of the memory, the time of producing the antibodies will be shorter. That's why sometimes we give vaccination in the beginning of some diseases like the measles and so on. What about the passive immunity? The passive immunity is ready antibodies. It will give the transient protection against an infectious agent, as we mentioned, like some specific, for example, zoster immunoglobulins. They're given in perinatal, for example, chickenpox, and so. And sometimes we have ready antibodies like measles immunoglobulins, rubella immunoglobulins, and so. And also, the passive immunity will cause protection for some diseases, and it may persist for 1 year after birth, as we mentioned, regards to the immunity given to the baby through the placenta. The major indication of passive immunity is in cases of immunodeficiency, like the beta lymphocyte defect, And again, for post-exposure prevention, as we mentioned, and with an infectious disease as part of a specific therapy for the disease. The definition of immunization is the process of inducing immunity against a specific disease. The vaccine or toxoid will stimulate the immune system to produce a prolonged humoral and or cellular immune response. We have the vaccination program here in Palestine. We give the common vaccines, we will speak later on, but some vaccines are not given in our country. It is available, sometimes given routinely, or in some cases, like the hepatitis A vaccine, the varicella vaccine, the meningococcal vaccines, this means B, C, and A, and the influenza vaccine. There is one vaccine which is a human papilloma virus vaccine, has been recommended for girls 11 to 12 years of age. What are the importance of the immunization? Immunization is considered one of the most beneficial and cost-effective disease preventive measures. As a result of effective and safe vaccination, smallpox is eradicated, and the poliomyelitis is eradicated as well from some of the Western countries. The incidence of most of the vaccine-preventable diseases of childhood has been reduced by more than 99%. This is the basic vaccination program in Palestine. It is crowded here and with a small litter, that's why we will see it in different pages. Here we will speak about the age of giving the vaccine type, the dose, the route of administration, and the site of giving the vaccine. In the first year of life or after birth, we give two vaccines, the BCG and the hepatitis B dose 1. The BCG is, you know, abbreviation for Bacillus of Calmette and Guerin, who discovered this vaccine. The dose is 0.05 ml. It is given intradermal in the left shoulder. You have to take care, you know, intradermal vaccine is important because this the BCG is live attenuated bacterial or bovine strain of bacteria of tuberculosis. That's why when live attenuated vaccine is given intradermal, it will produce as if it produced infection with bovine tuberculosis, but if it will go deep subcutaneous or intramuscular, it will cause several side effects, you know, maybe it will cause an abscess or regional lymph adenitis, and it may need some of the antitubercular or antitubercular treatment. The hepatitis B type 1, the first dose, is 0.5 ml. It is given intramuscular in the rectus femoris, in the middle outer quadrant of the thigh. At the age of 1 month, there is one vaccine is given, which is inactivated polio vaccine, dose 1. And this is given 0.5 ml subcutaneous in the left arm. We have 5 vaccines given at the age of 2 months. The 5 vaccines include the second dose of IPV, the penta vaccine. Penta vaccine contains five vaccines, the DTP, the R3, the hepatitis B number 4, and the hemophilus influenza type B, the fifth one. So the penta vaccine is given again 0.5 ml intramuscular in the rectus femoris muscle. We have the oral polio vaccine, the OPV, the first dose, which is bivalent vaccine, bivalent. Before the trivalent was given, but now only the bivalent, which is the common strains of the poliomyelitis. It is given in the form of 2 drops orally in the mouth. The fourth vaccine is the PCV, pneumococcal conjugate vaccine. The first dose will be given at age of 2 months, again 0.5 ml intramuscular in the rectus femoris. And the last vaccine given at the age of 2 months is the rotavirus vaccine. The nowadays given vaccine, it is called RotaVac vaccine. It is given in the dose of 0.5 ml orally in the mouth. Now, at the age of 4 months, we repeat the 4 vaccine. We given the second dose for penta, OPV, PCV, and rotavirus. There is no IPV vaccine. And the age of 6 months, we will give only 3 vaccines, the penta virus, the third dose, the bivalent oral polio vaccine, again the third dose, and the rotavirus vaccine, third dose. You notice that the PCV is not given at the age of 6 months. The third dose will be given at the age of 1 year. Now at the age of 1 year, the MMR vaccine will be given in the dose of 0.5 ml subcutaneous in the left arm, and the third dose of the PCV, as we mentioned before, will be given at the age of 1 year. While at the age of 18 months, another dose of the MMR will be given, and the DTP alone, the diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis vaccine, will be given in the dose of 0.5 ml intramuscular in the rectus femoris muscle. You notice that regarding the DTP, this is, you know, the nature of the vaccine diphtheria, it is toxoid, and the tetanus toxoid. Toxoid means detoxified toxin. This considered as an antigen. The toxicity of the vaccine itself or the toxin was removed, and it is only antigenic to produce antibodies. Why the pertussis vaccine, if it is written here like this, P alone, it is killed bacterial vaccine. That's why this is the type of the vaccine will make, you know, side effects. And sometimes it is severe in the form of pertussis encephalopathy. That's why now in the modern countries, and maybe in the future it will come here, there is AP vaccine, which is a cellular pertussis vaccine with very less complications. I hope we will have this vaccine in the very near future. But I think maybe with the penta vaccine, sometimes the AP, a cellular pertussis vaccine, is given, and it will be safe. The third vaccine given at age of 1.5 year is the bivalent oral polio vaccine, dose number 4. Now at the school entry, while we are taking the history, usually we ask the mother whether this child received vaccine at school entry or not. So with a school entry, there is the DT vaccine. DT, this means DT child. If it is written capital, this means diphtheria entered the tetanus, and they are toxoid, and this is given with the same dose of the DT and the DTP for children. Why, if you notice here, at age of 15 years, the TD TD is given, T the same dose of tetanus, but the diphtheria is a smaller dose of diphtheria vaccine. T capital and D is small. It's given at 15 years. Okay? So now that's here to show you some of the vaccines given in some European countries. This is the vaccination schedule in Spain. As you see here, we have the meningitis B, meningitis C vaccine, and meningitis B vaccine. Men B are given in the first year of life there, and later on the meningitis ACWY, this is at age later on at age of 11-12 years. So in the first year of life, in some countries we have, you know, meningitis is endemic in our country, and we hope that we will have men B and men C vaccine to be given to our children. Very important. Again, if you see here, notice that the varicella vaccine is given after age of 12 months. The varicella in the form of two doses, about 2 months in between them. And in some countries, you know, the MMRV vaccine, which is containing the measles, mumps, rubella, and varicella vaccine, are given all together. Again, if you look here, you will find influenza vaccine, which is annually given in some countries to the children. And here it will come in our country, of course, once a year, usually in October or November. But this is not free, and this is not included in the Palestinian program of immunization. Again, if you look here, there is the hepatitis A vaccine is given also to children around the age of 1 year. So this one will show that there are other vaccination other than our schedule we mentioned already are available in some countries. We hope by the time we'll have all the vaccination the same as the developed countries. Here we will give some ideas about the other vaccines like the influenza vaccine. Influenza vaccine is coming, as we told, to our country every year before winter, in October or November. And this year there was the tetravalent influenza vaccine, contains two strains from influenza A and two strains from influenza B. It is given annually. The indication, children with the chronic pulmonary disease like bronchial asthma, in cases of significant heart disease, if there is a immunocompromised child, immunocompromised people either having HIV or AIDS, children with sickle cell disease or other hemoglobinopathies like the thalassemia, beta thalassemia major, chronic renal dysfunction, chronic metabolic disease including diabetes mellitus, and healthy contact after the age of 5 years may receive live attenuated influenza vaccine. This is in the form of intranasal vaccine given after the age of 5 years, an alternative to trivalent influenza vaccine. The pneumococcal vaccine, as you know, we have the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine given in the first year of life. We have a PCV 7 recommended for all children less than 5 years of age who have conditions that place them at high risk for pneumococcal disease. And now it is routinely in the first year of life. Again, you know, you hear about this, the Pneumovax, the pneumococcal vaccine. It is usually this one given after the age of 2 years to those who have immune deficiency after splenectomy, or they have functional or anatomical splenia. In addition to the condition listed above for influenza, these conditions include cerebrospinal fluid leak, because you know usually those who have cerebrospinal fluid leak, they will be exposed to pneumococcal meningitis. That's why they have to receive the pneumococcal vaccine to control or to prevent the pneumococcal meningitis for them. Again, functional or anatomical splenia, we talked about that, the cochlear implant, because as if there is some defect, you know. The PPS23 given usually after the second year. This is an alternative to the Pneumovax we talked about. Two doses of PPS23 are recommended with an interval of 3 to 5 years between the doses. PPS means pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine 23. Now regarding the meningococcal vaccine, we talked about that there is meningococcal B vaccine and C vaccine given in the first year of life in developed countries. And the other meningococcal vaccine, as you know, it is given to pilgrimage who are going to Hajj. Again, it is recommended for functional or anatomical splenia, or those who are having the terminal complement component of proparidine deficiencies. If there is deficiency in the terminal complements, there is indication of meningococcal vaccine, because these children may be exposed to fulminant meningococcal disease. Here, this is very important, really, this slide, which is the vaccination in special cases. Now we will speak how to vaccinate the immunocompromised children. First of all, children with complement deficiency disorder can receive all the vaccines, either killed or live attenuated vaccines. Complement deficiency. This is number one. For children who are having the phagocytic disorders disease, this can receive both inactivated and live attenuated viral vaccines, but not live attenuated bacterial vaccine. This means the BCG is contraindicated in cases of phagocytic disorders. Now, regarding the children who are receiving corticosteroids, this is very important to understand this, because it is important you may work in the future in primary health care and to decide whether to give the vaccine to the children or not. And you know, some of the children will take corticosteroid for a long time, as those who are having the nephrotic syndrome or they have severe bronchial asthma. So regarding children receiving corticosteroid, if they are receiving the corticosteroid in the dose of 2 mg per kg per day or more for 14 or more days, yani at least 14 days, those should not receive live vaccines until therapy has been discontinued for at least 1 month. It's important to understand this point. Corticosteroid treatment, 2 mg per kg per day or more, for more than 2 weeks, then this patient should not receive the live attenuated vaccine except after one month of stopping this vaccine. But those children who are receiving the same dose, 2 mg per kg per day or more, but for less than 2 weeks, they can receive the live attenuated they receive the live attenuated vaccine as soon as they will stop the therapy. But those children who are taking lower doses of steroid may be vaccinated anytime while they are on therapy or after that. One point about the oral polio vaccine is no longer recommended routinely in the United States and in Europe because, as we mentioned earlier, that the poliomyelitis is eradicated there because of the vaccination. And as you know, there is a smallpox vaccine. This smallpox, in the past, it was there, but now worldwide it is eradicated, that it is not recommended anymore in children. This page is very important, the page regarding the vaccination, which is how to give the vaccine to the preterm infant. Usually preterm infant will take the vaccine the same as the term infant, with the same chronological age like the term, except for the hepatitis B vaccine. So all this page, it is as regards the hepatitis B vaccine. Here, infants weighing 2 kg or more, and 2000 grams or more, and who are stable may receive a birth dose. Hepatitis B vaccination should be differed in infants weighing less than 2 kg at birth until 30 days of age if born to hepatitis B surface antigen negative mother. Yani those preterm below the 2 kg, better, you know, to postpone their hepatitis B vaccination for 1 month if they have no problem, or they have delivered to normal mother without hepatitis B. But all preterm with low birth weight, were born to hepatitis B surface antigen positive mother should receive both hepatitis B immunoglobulin and the hepatitis B vaccine within 12 hours of birth. This is very important to protect, you know, the baby from getting infection from the mother, from the placenta, through the placenta. So any baby who is born to hepatitis B surface antigen positive mother, we have to give him the vaccine and the immunoglobulin. Usually we give the vaccine in one thigh and we give the immunoglobulin in the other thigh. This is very important. And if they are below 2,000 grams, this means we have to give an extra dose of hepatitis B vaccine after that, to substitute that dose which is given with the immunoglobulin to protect the baby. There is an important note here about the MMR and varicella vaccine. Here, attenuated vaccines like the MMR, varicella, or live attenuated influenza vaccine, if is not administered on the same day, should be given at least 1 month apart. Yani live attenuated vaccine are either given in one dose together in one sitting, or we have to postpone to make 1 month apart. Yani for example, sometimes the vaccine here in our country will be delayed and they will go to vaccinate their child at age, for example, MMR, at the age of for example, 1 year. We expect in the future we'll have varicella vaccine. If we consider that the varicella vaccine and MMR are available in one country and MMR was not there, it is not possible, if you give, for example, MMR vaccine, to give after 1 week or 2 weeks the varicella or any other live attenuated vaccines. This will make a very severe reaction to the baby. Now, what is the relation between the vaccination and immunoglobulin? And can we vaccinate the child who is receiving immunoglobulins? Now, immunoglobulin does not interfere with killed vaccine. And if the vaccine is killed vaccine, we can give it anytime because it is not like to be destructed to be destroyed by the vaccination itself. Now, immunoglobulin can interfere with the immune response to measles vaccine and by inference to varicella vaccine. Now again, immunoglobulin cannot interfere with the killed vaccine, though it will not affect the killed vaccine, immunoglobulin. The immunoglobulin will interfere with the immune response of measles. So if you give the measles vaccine after giving the immunoglobulin, you know the immunoglobulin will destroy the vaccine. That's why in infants, usually we postpone the measles vaccine, the MMR vaccine, until all the immunoglobulin given from the mother are fading away from the blood of the baby. If we give the measles vaccine earlier, while the baby has immunoglobulin from the mother, the measles vaccine will be destroyed and there will be no benefit to that child. This year, in the days of eye outbreaks, sometimes they are giving the measles vaccine earlier. This year it was given at age of 6 months, but the child will have to be given the measles vaccine again in the form of MMR at age of 1 year, because we don't know whether the immunoglobulin given by the mother to the baby will destroy the vaccine at 6 months, or they were removed from a blood or finished from the blood at that age. So this is only in epidemics we can give the measles vaccine at 6 months, but we don't know whether the vaccine will be destroyed by the immunoglobulin taken from the mother or not. That's why we postponed or give another booster dose at age of 1 year and at age of 18 months. Immunoglobulin, if needed, should be administered at least 2 weeks after measles vaccine. And we have a patient or a child who is in need to be given immunoglobulin, and we will give him, measles vaccine. So if we will give this child measles vaccine, we have to wait for 2 weeks, then we will start immunoglobulin, because this immunoglobulin, if it will be given during this time or with the measles vaccine, it will destroy the vaccine and the baby will not benefit from the vaccine. The last note here is that immunoglobulin is not expected to interfere with the immune response to the live attenuated influenza vaccine. This is really important, and usually you will find it sometimes in the multiple choice questions. We will speak briefly about some vaccines regarding precautions and adverse reaction. We talked about the BCG before. There is some precautions here in cases of HIV. The WHO recommended to give the BCG vaccine to asymptomatic infants in areas with high prevalence. This is a recommendation from the WHO. And if there is no manifestation for the baby after delivery, he has, for example, congenital HIV, if he is asymptomatic, still we can give him in the high prevalence areas of tuberculosis, we can give the BCG. You know the adverse reactions of the BCG, sometimes subcutaneous abscess, as we mentioned earlier, lymphadenitis, disseminated disease in immunodeficiency, because we told that it is live attenuated bacterial vaccine, and it is a bovine strain of bacteria of tuberculosis, and it will introduce infection by this bovine strain if there is immune deficiency of the child. Hepatitis B vaccine, we have three doses. The dose given at the age or in the first year of life, usually the pediatric dose, which is 10 milligrams. There is another dose, which is the adult dose given after the age of 10 years, which is the double of the pediatric dose, which is 20 milligrams. And those who are on dialysis should receive 40 milligram vaccine. This vaccine, the hepatitis B vaccine, is prepared from hepatitis B surface antigen secreted by recombinant carbohydrate cells or CHO cells, then purified and inactivated. There is no contraindication for the hepatitis B vaccine. A few adverse reactions like local pain in duration or muscle pain. This last one we talked about it. The infants born to hepatitis B surface antigen positive mothers will be given hepatitis B immunoglobulin in the same time of giving the vaccine. The DPT, we talked also briefly about the contraindication, and the main contraindication is from the pertussis, because the pertussis here containing all the cells, and we told you before that if there is a small A before the P, this means a cellular pertussis vaccine with no side effects. But the pertussis vaccine per se can cause encephalopathy. That's why the contraindication, usually if there is an immediate prophylactic reaction, we don't need to give the second dose DPT. We give DT child instead of giving the DPT, because or it can make encephalopathy within 7 days after giving the vaccine. This is absolute contraindication, but regarding the precautions, convulsion with or without fever within 3 days of giving the DPT, persistent severe crying for 3 or more hours within 48 hours, collapse or shock-like syndrome within 48 hours if the temperature is 40.5 or more. Here you can differ the dose in progressive neurological disorders. If the patient has progressive neurological disorders, we give him DT only, DT child only, and we remove the pertussis vaccine. Otherwise, this pertussis vaccine will cause severe reaction to them. Briefly, regarding the DPT, the side effects and contraindication because of the pertussis, because it can cause pertussis encephalopathy. That's why nowadays in the developed countries, the pertussis vaccine given is not the killed bacteria, but it is the acellular pertussis vaccine with no side effects like the pertussis vaccine. That's why in some countries they write DTP instead of DPT, because diphtheria and pertussis, the component is toxoid, while the pertussis is killed bacteria or acellular pertussis. The oral polio vaccine is considered a live attenuated vaccine and the most severe disease if it will be given to immunocompromised. That's why it is contraindicated if the child has immune deficiency, or if the child is in contact or brother or somebody who is living with a patient with immune deficiency, it is contraindicated. The IPV vaccine is indicated in that way. So the IPV, inactivated polio vaccine, used when the oral polio is contraindicated, it is given in close contact to immune deficient. And if there is close contact to a patient with immune deficiency. The contraindication of the measles vaccine, the same as live attenuated vaccines. Adverse reactions, you know, adverse reactions of the measles vaccines are minor, like fever, runny nose, mild skin rash. Very, very, very rarely the subacute sclerosing pain encephalitis. There is here important note that the tuberculin test may become temporarily negative after the measles vaccine. This is the relation between the measles and vaccine and the tuberculosis. And you know, even those patients who will have measles sometimes will affect not only the tuberculin test, but also can cause flaring of tuberculosis. The new vaccine is cultured in human diploid cells with no reaction to egg allergy. Before, the measles vaccine was prepared in the chick embryo. That's why those children who have allergy to the eggs may develop anaphylaxis or anaphylactic shock. That's why that one was contraindicated to them, but the nowadays, measles vaccine is not producing this reaction. The MMR vaccines, adverse reaction, joint pain, usually because of the rubella, rarely lymph node enlargement, parotitis because of the mumps, orchitis or meningoencephalitis. All these complications are due to the mumps component of the vaccine, but they are very rare. Haemophilus influenza vaccine, the component is polysaccharide conjugate to protein. Polysaccharide conjugate. It will prevent meningitis and epiglottitis as well. No contraindication, adverse reaction only, mild swelling in 24% of the patient. Pneumococcal vaccine, we talked about pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, and we told that we have the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine. We told that it is given in the first year of life, while the polysaccharide pneumococcal vaccine is given after the age of 2 years with the following indications like sickle cell anemia, functional or anatomical asplenia, nephrotic syndrome, a chronic Lyme disease. The meningococcal vaccine, we told that in the modern or developed countries, there is meningitis B and meningitis C given in the first year of life. But here we don't have except the vaccine which is given after the age of 2 years, either those who are going to Hajj, pilgrimage, or those who have, sickle cell anemia, asplenia, terminal complement deficiency. And if everyone wants a vaccine, there is routine one given in the first year of life in some countries. This is trivalent influenza vaccine. And there is the annual one. This year it was tetravalent vaccine, as we mentioned before, given after the age of 2 years annually. After the 5 year, if there is a risk factor, we give the influenza vaccine. The risk factor like chronic lung disease, sickle cell anemia, chronic salicylate therapy, chronic immunosuppression, and others like HIV, diabetes, chronic renal disease, hospital personnel to protect them. Varicella vaccine, it's important, and we told it's given in some countries at the age of 12 months, either with the MMR or separate. It is given in two doses, one dose at 12 months of age and the second dose at age 4 to 6 years. The rotavirus vaccine started in Palestine in year 2016. In the beginning, it was the Rotavac. That's why you have to differentiate between them. The Rotarix, it was in the beginning, which was given 1.5 ml only in the second and after 2 months or 4 months, while the available one here in Gaza and Palestine is the Rotavac vaccine, which is given in the dose 0.5 ml orally, and it is given at ages of 2, 4, and 6 months. Three doses, not two doses. The rotavirus vaccine possible side effects like cough, runny nose, high temperature, loss of appetite, vomiting, diarrhea on a daily basis during the first week following each dose, and rarely intussusception. Rotavirus vaccine, as you know, in the beginning of giving this vaccine, there was a lot of cases, you know, of intussusception because causing congestion in the gut. That's why it was stopped for a long time. Then now the new vaccines like the Rotarix and Rotavac, which is given now with very, very, very minimal side effects regarding the intussusception. Now, the indication of vaccination after exposure. You know, those who are exposed to measles, as you know, in the epidemics, we can give the contact, you know, a booster dose of MMR, or we can give the patient himself early in the incubation period can be given, you know, measles vaccine. So the measles vaccine should be given to the exposed one during 72 hours of exposure. Also, as a treatment of measles, we can give the hepatitis, another point of indication of the vaccine after exposure is the hepatitis B immunoglobulins. There is, tetanus vaccine given also after exposure, and the rabies vaccine as part of treatment to induce immunity. What are the contraindications to immunization? The severe febrile illness. This means if it is mild upper respiratory infection, there is false contraindication. Again, some people they think that when the child is given antibiotic, this is contraindication, but it is not contraindication to vaccination. As we mentioned, the short steroid course, less than 2 weeks, or the dose less than 2 milligrams, anytime you can give the vaccine, if it, the dose if it's lower than 2 milligrams per kg per day. Again, false contraindication of the vaccine is the premature or low birth weight baby, or those who history of non-specific allergic disease, allergy, there is no contraindication of the vaccine. So we have now in the last slides, you know, the contraindication in general of the live attenuated vaccine. Number one, the immune deficiency, patients who are having leukemia, malignancy, symptomatic HIV. Those who are on large dose of steroid, as we mentioned before, within 3 weeks of another live vaccine, or 1 month, as we mentioned, either to give live vaccines together or to postpone the second one. Within 3 weeks before or 3 months after immunoglobulin or plasma. This is contraindication. And those patients with TB not given measles vaccine unless on full treatment. Here we have some exception. For example, children who are having leukemia, usually during the remission, when the CD4 cells are high, we can give modified vaccine, especially for the varicella vaccine to protect them. I hope if you have any questions, you can send to the email or through my through the messenger, the Facebook, and I will be happy, you know, to answer about any question. So by the end of this lecture, everybody of the student, I hope, will know the types of immunity, the indication of passive immunity, the importance of vaccination, the basic vaccination program, very important for the students, you know, to when they are taking the history. The vaccination in special conditions, we have some, you know, to know also everybody now by the end of this lecture will know the remarks of different vaccination, as we mentioned, how to vaccinate children after exposure to the disease, and the contraindications of vaccination, especially the live attenuated vaccine. This is the reference, and thank you very much.